Hi everyone, this is module 1. In module 1 you have 3 chapters: energy resources, basic concepts of thermodynamics, and steam formation. In this lecture we will discuss about the energy resources. Energy, this definition you already know. Energy is a capacity to do work. What are the energy sources available? In this chapter, the energy resources, we are going to discuss what are the energy sources available and how we are going to utilize energy resources to convert to electrical power. So the first one is energy sources. And the energy sources, the two major types of energy sources are the capital energy and the celestial energy sources. Capital energy is nothing but the energy which is in the earth. The energy which exists in the earth is a capital energy. Examples are fossil fuels, nuclear fuels, and heat traps, right? Fossil fuels is nothing but petroleum, diesel. Petroleum is nothing but after fractional distillation, we get petrol, diesel, kerosene, and all. The coal, everything is a fossil fuel. Same way, the second type is celestial energy sources. Celestial energy sources is nothing but the energy that comes from outer space is called celestial or income energy. And these are the examples: electromagnetic, gravitational, and practical energy, particle energy from stars, planet, moon, etc. Electromagnetic energy is because of the sun, that is called direct solar energy. This results in wind, hydel, geothermal, biofuel, etc. Gravitational energy is nothing but, you know, it is because of moon produces tidal energy. Based on whether the energy sources can be renewed or it cannot be renewed, based on that there are again two types. One is renewable sources of energy and second one is non-renewable sources of energy. What is renewable? As the name explains, renewable is nothing but the energy sources which will be renewed, which will never be exhausted. It is inexhaustible. That is called renewable energy sources. And these are all the examples: direct solar energy, wind energy, tidal, hydel, ocean thermal energy, bioenergy. All these things are the renewable sources of energy. What are the major advantages and disadvantages of this? Now, as the name itself explains, it is inexhaustible. So that is the first advantage of it. The second one is can be matched in scale to the need and can deliver quality energy. Except the biomass, all other sources are pollution free in this. Okay, that is a major advantages of this. And same way, there are some disadvantages. Major disadvantage is that the energy which is available is intermittent. That is a major disadvantage of this. And solar energy received at the earth is dependent on the local atmospheric condition. Okay. Technology is not fully developed to meet the present requirement. These are a few disadvantages of this renewable sources of energy. What is non-renewable energy sources? It will be exhausted one day. Examples are fossil fuels. As I mentioned, petroleum, coal, all those things are the fossil fuels, nuclear fuels, and heat traps. All these things are the non-renewable sources of energy. Differences. Some of the differences I already mentioned in the while explaining advantages and disadvantages. As name explains, it is, you know, it will not be exhausted, but non-renewable sources will be exhausted one day. It emits low carbon, but it emits high carbon. Here, because of unlimited quantity only, it will not be exhausted. But here, this non-renewable sources, it is available in a limited quantity, so it will be exhausted one day. And energy sources are pollution free, except biomass. But non-renewable sources are not pollution free. These energy resources are not pollution free. In this, you know, large land area is required for unit power, but for the same unit power, this requires the non-renewable sources requires less land area. And these are the examples. The types of fuel. As I mentioned in the energy sources, we are going to study, we are going to discuss what are the energy sources available, what are the types of fuel available. Then we will study how we are going to convert energy resources to produce electricity. The type of fuel, here we classify the type of fuel based on the state of it. One is solid, liquid and gaseous. Solid fuel, wood and coal are the major constituents in the solid fuel. Wood is, generally it is for a domestic purpose, for cooking purpose. Of course, nowadays it is rarely used. Now wood is generally used for furniture or for some interior purpose. Second one in a solid fuel is coal. Okay, whatever I mentioned here, these are all the stages which undergoes to finally form anthracite. Second state is a liquid fuel. As I already mentioned, petroleum, crude oil or petroleum. These are all hydrocarbons. Okay. After fractional distillation, we get this petrol, diesel, petroleum, coke, kerosene, all those things we get after fractional distillation. Gaseous fuel, natural gas and manufactured gas. This natural gas, it is found near oil source. Methane and other light hydrocarbons, ethane, propane, pentane, etc. are the constituents in the natural gas. Manufactured gas, coal gas, coke oven gas, producer gas. Solid fuels, as I mentioned, wood and coal are the solid fuels. Wood, it is a fuel such as firewood, charcoal, chips, sheets, pellets and sawdust. In many areas, wood is the most easily available form of fuel, requiring no tools in the case of picking up dead wood or few tools. Or it may require few tools, but to pick up the dead woods, it requires no tools. Okay, minimum tools will be required. The use of wood as a fuel source for heating is much older than the civilization. Today, burning of wood is the largest use of energy derived from the solid fuel biomass. Wood fuel can be used for cooking and heating. Wood may be used indoors in a furnace, stove or fireplace, or outdoors in a furnace, campfire or bonfire. Solid fuels, the coal. The coal is a major fuel used for thermal power plants to generate steam. This coal occurs in nature, which was formed by the decay of vegetable matters buried under the earth millions of years ago under pressure and heat. It is almost, it takes around 325 million of years to form a coal. This phenomenon of transformation of vegetable matter into coal under earth's crust is known as metamorphism. The type of coal available under the earth's surface depends upon the period of metamorphism, how much time it takes. Based on that, the type of coal is available. Okay, as I mentioned, for forming anthracite coal, it takes around 325 million of years. Okay. Here, the major constituents in coal is moisture, 5 to 40%, volatile matter, it may be combustible or incombustible substances, about 50% volatile matter will be there, and ash, 20 to 50%. The chemical substances in this coal are carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen and sulfur. Okay, so in this metamorphism phenomenon, the vegetable matters undergoes the transformation from peat to anthracite coal. As I mentioned while explaining the type of fuel, it takes four stages. Peat, generally ignite, what happens,
bituminous, then
during the swamp areas, the swamp forest areas, when the plants are died, it sank below the water and began the process of coal formation. what happens when it sank below the water? Since it is died, the decomposition has to take place. But since the dead plants are below the water surface, there is no oxygen available. So the complete decomposition will not take place. The partial decomposition takes place. Okay. So as the partial decomposition takes place, after some period of time, if there is any sediments collected over those dead plants, some pressure will be applied on those partial decomposed plants, and because of that some temperature is also generated. So the combination of this pressure and temperature is the reason why the coal is formed. But it will take many years of time, that is 325 millions of years, that much of years it will take for the complete formation. What are the four stages? As I mentioned, peat, lignite, bituminous and anthracite. Peat is the first stage. Okay, so I know this is the first stage of formation of coal. Normally vegetable matter is oxidized to water and carbon dioxide. If the plant material accumulates underwater, as I mentioned, oxygen is not present, and so only partial decomposition occurs. Because of this incomplete decomposition, it leads to the accumulation of organic substances called peat. Now this peat is fibrous, soft, it is spongy, in which the plant's remains are easily recognizable. It contains a large amount of water, so it must be dried before we use this. For the formation of peat, it will take around 1000 years. The second stage is lignite. Again, what happens after some period of time, maybe around 60 millions of years. Okay, this much of time it takes for the formation of lignite. So for this much of period, during this time, what happens? More amount of sediments will be collected over the dead plants. Because of that, more pressure and more temperature will be building up inside the plant, inside the dead plants. Because of that, you know, some amount of moisture will be removed. That way, the carbon content will be increased. Okay. So because of that, the lignite is formed. It will take around 60 millions of years. Okay. So this lignite is dark brown in color, and like peat, it contains traces of plants. It is found in many places, but is used only when more efficient fuel is not available. Okay. It crumbles very easily. That means it breaks or fall apart into small fragments. So it's not easy for the carrying purpose. So the third stage is bituminous coal. This bituminous coal is largely available, okay, because it will take around 300 millions of years. This again, if you leave for another 25 millions of years, then anthracite will be formed. Largely available coal now is bituminous coal, that is the third stage of coal. This coal, you know, it is called as a soft coal. Okay? The carbon content in this is around 85%, because what happens, so after 60 million, the lignite is formed. After that, again, it will take around 240 millions of years. So during that time, more amount of sediments will be, covering that dead plants. Because of that, high pressure and high temperature, because of that, so much of moisture will be removed. So the carbon content in this is around 85%. Okay. It is greatly used in industry as a source of heat energy. Okay. So these are the major applications: cement, wood, food, paper, automobile, textile and plastic industries. Anthracite, of course, it is the first stage. It is the final stage of coal. It is also called as hard coal. Okay. because it is very hard and looks almost metallic and has a high luster. It is the highest rank of coal we call, which means that it has the highest heating value and highest carbon content with fewest impurities. Okay, that is the reason we call that as a highest rank of coal. We call anthracite as a highest rank of coal. Carbon content is between 92% to 98% because it will take another 25 millions of years time. Again, more pressure, more temperature, because there's so much of moisture will be removed. So the carbon content will be 92% to 98%. Okay. This anthracite, you know, it burns a lot of time with more heat and you know, with less dust. Second one, coke. The next one, coke. Now, this coke is a fuel with a high carbon content and few impurities. What we'll do, we'll heat the bituminous coal, because largely available coal is bituminous. We will heat the bituminous coal in the absence of oxygen. Okay. Because of that, again, the moisture will be removed. And because of that, the carbon content will be increased. Okay, that is called as coke. This is the solid carbonaceous material derived from destructive distillation of low ash and the low sulfur bituminous coal. Cokes are gray, you know, it is hard, porous with high carbon content and few impurities. Coke can be formed naturally, but the commonly used form is the synthetic. The second state, that is liquid fuel. Okay. Generally, you know, all types of liquid fuels used are derived from crude oil and its byproducts. The petroleum or this crude oil, right, it consists of 80 to 85% carbon, 10 to 15% hydrogen, and varying percentage of sulfur, nitrogen, oxygen, and compounds of some vanadium. It is all very little percentage in the crude oil. But major constituent is the carbon, that is 80 to 85%, and 10 to 15% hydrogen will be there. This crude oil is refined by fractional distillation to obtain fuel oils, that is petrol, diesel, kerosene. All those things will be getting after the fractional distillation of petroleum. The heavy oil is used for the generation of steam. The fractions from light oil to heavy oil are naphtha, gasoline, kerosene, diesel, and finally heavy fuel oil. Petroleum based oils, already we discussed, how the petroleum is formed. Now, it is formed mainly from ancient microscopic plants and bacteria that lived in the ocean and saltwater seas. What happens, these microorganisms, when it is dyed, it settled to the sea floor. Then they mixed with sand silt to form organic rich mud, which was gradually heated and compressed, chemically transforming into petroleum. How the coal is formed, the same way it is forming. Okay. Again, what happens, this will be covered with some sand silt. Because of that, again, pressure and temperature will be increased. Because of that only, the partial decomposition takes place. So because of these reasons, the petroleum will be formed. This liquid petroleum gases are less dense than the water. So it moves upwards through Earth's crust. It passes through an impermeable layer of rock, which traps the petroleum, creating a reservoir of petroleum and natural gas. From there only, we'll dig. Then from there, we'll get the petroleum and natural gas. Wherever there is a petroleum, above that, the natural gas is always available. Petroleum, it is yellowish black liquid. Okay, it is natural occurring. commonly, you know, referred into these various types of fuel, the major fuels we have taken. That is petrol, diesel, kerosene. Petrol can also be called as gasoline. This gasoline or petrol is a colorless petroleum, you know, flammable liquid that is used primarily as a fuel in spark ignited internal combustion engine, that is SIEG. The specific gravity is around 0.75. It vaporizes and ignites easily at low temperature. Second one is a diesel. Diesel fuel is any liquid fuel used in diesel engines. In this, fuel ignition takes place without any spark as a result of compression. Because the compression, that compression temperature is enough for the auto ignition. So we don't need any spark plug there. The fuel injector, when it injects the fuel, it will start burning. Now, this diesel engine have found, you know, broad use as a result of higher thermal efficiency and thus fuel efficiency. This diesel engine, it is having a higher thermal efficiency. The specific gravity of this diesel fuel is in the range of 0.82 to 0.95. Kerosene. Now, this kerosene is also known as paraffin, lamp oil, and coal oil. This kerosene, it is generally a combustible hydrocarbon liquid, which is derived from petroleum. It is widely used as a fuel in industry as well as, you know, households. Kerosene is widely used to power jet engines of aircraft, jet fuel, and some rocket engines, and is commonly used as a cooking and lighting fuel. Again, the specific gravity of this kerosene is 0.8. The third type of fuel based on the state, that is gaseous fuel, the natural gas. Generally, you know, for the generation of steam in gas-fired thermal plants, either natural gas or manufactured gaseous fuel are used. However, the manufactured gases are costlier than the natural gases. Generally, this natural gas is used for power plants as it is available in abundance. The natural gas is generally obtained from gas wells and petroleum wells. As I mentioned, wherever there is a petroleum, above that, there is a natural gas available. So the major constituent of this natural gas is methane, that is about 60 to 65%. It contains small amounts of other hydrocarbons such as ethane, naphthenic and aromatics, carbon dioxide and nitrogen. The major problem in this natural gas is that it is very difficult to store. A small leakage also, you know, leads to, so gas will be leaked out. So the major problem of natural gas is the storage. This natural gas is generally colorless, odorless, and it is non-toxic. The calorific value of this natural gas is around 25,000 to 50,000 kilojoule per meter cube. That much of calorific value is there for the natural gas. This gaseous fuel have high advantages similar to those of liquid fuels, as I mentioned, except for the storage problems. That is a major problem with the natural gas. The storage is a major problem. Liquefied petroleum gas, LPG. This LPG is prepared by refining petroleum or wet natural gas and is almost entirely derived from fossil fuel sources. It burns relatively cleanly with no soot and very few sulfur emissions. As it is a gas, it does not cause ground or water pollution hazards, but it can cause air pollution. Now, this LPG will evaporate quickly at normal temperatures and pressures, and is usually supplied in pressurized steel vessels. How generally, you know, what is liquefied petroleum gas? The name itself explains. It is a gas which is liquefied. So generally in the cylinder, it is a liquid. But when it is coming out, when you release the valve, when it is coming outside, it converts to a gas. There are main, you know, few dangers in this. There are two main dangers from this that. The first one is, you know, there is a possible explosion if the mixture of LPG and air is within the explosive limits and if there is an ignition source. There is a first danger thing with respect to this LPG. The second one is that there may be suffocation due to LPG displacing air, causing a decrease in oxygen concentration. These two are the major, you know, problem with LPG.